All right, hey folks, today we're taking a look at Ansys Mechanical version 18.1, and what I'm going to show you I'm sure would apply to earlier or later versions, so go ahead and stick around and take a look at what I got. So what I want to talk to you about is how to apply a force or a torque load to a body or several bodies in your model and vary them spatially, in other words in the X, Y, and or Z directions. So let me demonstrate what I mean. If we come up here to the static structural system and right click and insert a pressure, we can apply it to the outside of the pipe. Down here we can change the magnitude to be tabular. We can then set the independent variable to be X, Y, or Z. And in this case, Z is along the axis of the pipe. So I could then come over to this table in the lower right and populate it to vary the pressure load axially along the pipe. Suppose I had a scenario where the torque inside the pipe varied along the axis. I could come here and insert a moment. I could apply it to this inside face. Under magnitude, I can change it to tabular, but we notice that the independent variable limits us to time or step. Even if I come up here and change this to components and try again to set it to tabular, we notice one more time that we're limited to time and step. In other words, we cannot vary it in the Z direction along the axis. And the same problem occurs if you wanted to apply a force, such as maybe a varying thrust along the axis. So what I'm going to show you is how you can write a command object like we have here to go ahead and pull this off and vary loads in the X, Y, and or Z directions. So what I'm going to do is pause here and undo these couple changes I made and revert back to the original model, and then we'll get started. All right, so the first thing I want to take a look at is the geometry of this pipe. Since if you have some awareness of a few relevant dimensions, you'll probably have a better understanding in a little bit when I show you how to construct the command snippet. So if I come up here to the geometry branch, I can come out to the workspace and click on the inside of the pipe. And down in the status bar, it's telling us that the radius of this cylinder is 5 inches. So if I click on this end face, spin it around, control click, and get the other end face, I come down to this status bar, double click to bring up this additional window, and it's telling us that the distance between these two selected objects is 120 inches in the Z direction. So it's a 120 inch long pipe, and for this demonstration, I'm going to show you how to vary the torque and the thrust load along the axis. In other words, from 0 to 59 inches, we will have a given torque and thrust. From 60 to 120, we will have a different torque and thrust. And I'm going to show you how to do that with the command object. So one of the first things you're going to want to think about is a coordinate system, a local coordinate system, because it's very possible that the body you're thinking of doing this to is not aligned well with the global coordinate system. And especially in a case like this where a cylindrical coordinate system may be an even better choice. And the reason is, later in the command snippet, we're going to create these varying loads by applying forces to the body according to the axes of that local coordinate system. So if the local coordinate system is aligned to the body appropriately, then the forces will be aligned to the body appropriately. So if we come over here to the coordinate system branch, you'll notice I created a cylindrical coordinate system. And it's shown here on the right end of the pipe, where X is radial, Y is theta, and Z is axial. And I have it centered at global location 0, 0, 0, which happens to be the end of that pipe. You could instead change this to geometry selection and place its origin somewhere else on the body. Once I did that, I changed the coordinate system field to manual. Then this additional field below it appeared to assign a coordinate system ID number. There's approximately 10 predefined coordinate systems in the mechanical solver, which is actually the APDL solver. So you don't want to interfere with those 10, so pick an ID number sufficiently beyond that, and in this case I chose 99. In the command snippet later, we're going to reference that coordinate system ID number. Okay, so next we want to think about loads and boundary conditions. Go ahead and create your boundary conditions like normal. But I want to specifically take a look at this pressure. To facilitate this process, go ahead and create a pressure on the face of interest, the face that you want to create the varying load on later. and give this pressure an arbitrary magnitude. What this is going to do is force the solver to create surface elements on that face. We can then use those surface elements and their nodes to apply the forces for the varying loads. And if in fact we don't want any effects at a pressure, we can activate one other command after the fact to wipe out the pressure load. Okay, so let's go ahead and dive into this command object so we can understand how to put it together to apply the varying loads. And the first thing I want to draw your attention to are these header statements at the top of the command object. They're put in there by default. So let me go ahead and insert a brand new one to show you. Specifically, I want to point out this statement here. It says that the active unit system and workbench when this object was created is US customary. And that unit system is pulled directly from this dropdown where we have specified US customary. If we instead specify something like a metric system, come back to the environment branch, insert another brand new command object, we notice that it's now displaying metric units. That's important because as you insert script variables below, such as radii, torques, or forces, or what have you, you have to insert them in the active unit system for the model. So you'll want to be aware of that, because then when they're sent to the solver later, they're going to be processed according to that unit system that the solver is using. So let me go ahead and delete both of these command objects that I recently put in since they're not needed. And we'll go ahead and reset the unit system back to US customary. So the assumption here is that you have some basic understanding of the APDL command language. But if your understanding is a little sparse and you want to go ahead and freshen up, feel free to pull up your help menu, come here to the Advanced Search tab, check this box for Command Search, and you can type in the commands line by line to go ahead and take a look at what they mean. So here we're looking at NSLE, and we can read down through to understand what that command does. I'm going to go through the command object line by line, just giving a high-level overview of what's taking place at each step. Two things I want to point out from the get-go. Number one, exclamation points at the head of some of the lines. This basically means that the APDL solver is going to ignore those lines. They're useful for inserting commentary or deactivating commands that we don't want carried out. The other thing is these input arguments. It's a nice feature available in Workbench Mechanical that we're going to take advantage of. So for instance, arg1 is equal to 0, arg2 is equal to 59, arg3 is equal to 60, and arg4 is equal to 120. These happen to be the increments along the pipe axis where I'm going to change the load values. And we have arg5 and 6 where I input different loads. These input arguments are going to be fed into the script when the APDL solution takes place. We could manually type the values in the script, but we're just going to take advantage of this convenient feature here where we can type them into the details of this command object. So let's go ahead and take a look at this first cluster of commands in my command object. The commentary above says that we're going to grab surface elements and their nodes and rotate them into a cylindrical coordinate system. The first command is /prep7, which is going to revert us back to the preprocessor of the APDL workflow. So if you look at the very first statement in the command object, it says that commands inserted into this file will be executed just prior to the Ansys solve command, which infers that we're in the solution processor. So if we issue /prep7, we can revert back to the preprocessor to carry out some of these preliminary commands. So after prep7, we have ecell, S, which is going to select all of the surface elements that were created as a result of that pressure load we talked about earlier. NSLE is going to select all the nodes associated to those surface elements. CSYS.99 is going to activate the 99th coordinate system, which we talked about earlier being the cylindrical coordinate system. NRotate.all is going to rotate all the selected nodes into that coordinate system. NCell.r is going to take the selected nodes and reselect a subset in the Z direction between 60 and 120. And actually it is a great example where you can manually input script variables. So to be safe and to be consistent, we can change this to be arg3, arg4. That way the data is read directly from the details of the command object. The next command is *get, And the way it's constructed, it's going to count all of the selected nodes and assign that value to a parameter called node count. Next, we have csys, 0, which is going to activate the global Cartesian coordinate system. Slash solu is going to put us back in the solution processor and prepare us for the subsequent commands. The final command there in the cluster is sfe delete. If I go ahead and remove this exclamation point, it's going to remove the pressure effects that we talked about earlier. If I want the pressure effects on the model, I can go ahead and leave the exclamation point there. So I want to pause here before moving on to the next cluster of commands, because I want to talk further about NSEL and star-get. So for your understanding, the pipe in this demonstration is loaded as such. From 0 to 59 inches, it'll have no thrust and no torque. From 60 to 120 inches, it'll have a uniform thrust and a uniform torque. And for those who are curious, any nodes that are between 59 and 60 inches will have a load on them that is linearly interpolated between the discrete values at 59 and 60. So what I'm doing with NSEL is I'm selecting all the nodes between 60 and 120 inches, and then I'm counting them. Because later I'm going to apply a fraction of the load to each node. So for example, suppose my load is 200 pounds and I have 20 nodes that are in that region. That means that 10 pounds is going to be applied to each node, so that the total sum is 200. Therefore, on your body, if you have one section it should be loaded a certain way, and another section it should be loaded a different way, you may need to go through this nodal selection logic several times to select the nodes for the different regions and then count them. Now I want to move on and talk about the next cluster of commands where we define the loads and apply them to the model. And we start out talking about torque. First we have the star-dim command. Star-dim creates an empty array in the model. And later we populate the array. In this case, the name of the array is torque_load. It's of the type table. It has 4 rows, 2 columns, and 1 plane. In the 7th field of the syntax, we declare that the rows represent the z-coordinate on the model. In the 8th field of the syntax, we declare that the columns represent the time aspect. So speaking of time, you could come over here to analysis settings and change your number of steps to be something greater than 1. You could then come back to your command object and expand the table to accommodate additional time steps. And because arrays of the type table are somewhat peculiar from the other types of arrays, star-dim is one command that I strongly suggest you bring up in the help menu. This way you can read about it to understand how arrays of the type table are treated and how they behave. For instance, one peculiarity they have is that they possess a zero row and a zero column. And these act as index numbers for the cells of the array. And these can be useful for such things as I mentioned earlier. For example, the z-coordinate of the model or the time aspect of the solution. So now that we have the empty table created, we can go ahead and populate its cell values to include the zero row and the zero column. And that's what we start out with here, where we're defining the zero row as the time values, 0 and 1. We go on to define the z values in the zero column, arg1, arg2, arg3, and arg4. And these are the relevant dimensions along the axis of the pipe that are needed to fully define our load on the pipe. We then go below to define the actual load values in the cells. And if you look here, 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 and here, you'll notice that the load values are 0. And that's because each of these cells in the array are at the zero time step. And of course, our model starts out with no loading, and the load is linearly ramped up to the completion of the first load step. So if we look here and here, we notice our load is 0 at the completion of the first load step. And that's because these cell values represent the loading between 0 and 59 inches. And I mentioned earlier that that portion of the pipe has no loading on it. But if you look here and here, you'll notice I applied the arg5 load at the completion of the first load step. And notice that it's divided by node count because I'm applying a fraction of the load to each node. And these loads are being applied in a nodal coordinate system that we rotated the nodes into earlier. So we have a 200,000 pound load simulating a torque around the axis of this pipe. And so one subtlety you need to be aware of here, we're applying this as a force, which means that the force times the inner radius of the pipe, in other words, the moment arm, creates a 1 million inch pound torque. So be aware of that subtlety if you're in a similar situation as this where you're trying to apply a torque on a pipe. Finally, we're following up with the F command where we apply the load to all selected nodes in the Y axis of the nodal coordinate system from the torque underscore load table. And I want to point out one other small subtlety about the F command. It's smart enough to linearly interpolate loads between the discretely defined values in the table. So you'll notice that I defined a 200,000 pound rotational force at the 60 inch location and 120 inch location on the pipe. Suppose instead I defined a 200,000 pound rotational force at the 60 inch location and a 300,000 pound rotational force at the 120 inch location. The F command is smart enough to know that the load should be linearly ramped between the 60-inch location and the 120-inch location. It's not necessary for me to define any other loading except at the endpoints of 60 and 120. And so if we scroll further down in the command object, we can see how the thrust load was defined in a very similar manner. And I'm not going to reiterate all the nasty details, but you can see how I use the arg6 input argument to define a 10,000 pound thrust load at the 60 inch location and the 120 inch location. So the whole latter half of the pipe has a 10,000 pound thrust load on it. And you can see in the F command, I defined it in the nodal coordinate system in the Z direction. And so I follow up at the very end with an all cell command, which is intended to select all entities of the model that were previously unselected and deactivated. So now everything is selected and active and ready for the solver to complete the solution. And we're going to do just that right now. So let's go ahead and send this off to solve. We'll come up here, we'll click the solve button and give it a little bit to finish the solution. All right, great, the solution's complete. So let's go ahead and take a look at our force and moment reactions to see what kind of results we got and if they are what we expect. So we take a look down here in the details for the force reaction, and we notice in the Z axis, the force reaction is minus 10,000 pounds, and that's what we expected because the thrust that we applied was positive 10,000 pounds. If we take a look at the moment reaction, in the details we notice that the reaction moment is minus 1 million pound inches, and that's again what we expect. Remember that we applied a 200,000 pound rotational force to the inside of the pipe. The inner radius is 5 inches, so 200,000 pounds times that moment arm of 5 inches gives us a minus 1 million pound inch reaction, just as we expected. So we can go ahead and take a look at the total deformation, just to amuse ourselves, and the equivalent stress as well. And you can clearly see that the latter half of the pipe between 60 and 120 inches has more loading taking place on it. All right, great. So that about wraps it up for what I wanted to show you. I showed you how you can put together a command object to apply variable loading to your model. So the assumption here is that you would now have some better understanding so that you can take these commands and expand or extrapolate them to fit your situation with your model. So I appreciate you tuning in and thanks for watching.